Simon & Schuster Audio presents Pretend I'm Dead, a novel by Jen Beagin, read by Candace Thaxton. Hole. For months, he was just a number to her. She counted his dirties, he dropped them in the bucket, she recorded the number on the clipboard, and he moved down the line. Another pelican, mired in oil, worn to the stump, and nodding to his own ruin. A goner, like the rest of them. Then, after switching to the needle station, instead of counting, she handed out clean rigs, she noticed that he was the only exchanger carrying library books. Biographies, mostly, and crime fiction. She dubbed him Mr. Disgusting on account of his looks and dirty clothes. His hair was a long, angry scribble in need of hot oil treatment, his face an overworked drawing with too many wrinkles, but he was tall and broad-shouldered and could carry her around the block or up a flight of stairs if he ever needed or wanted to, a quality she'd found lacking in her previous boyfriends, and she was pretty much in love with his eyes, which were dark, frank in their expression, and seemed to say, "You are here." It was supposed to rain that night, the night of their first conversation. Half of the exchangers stood under a tarp, half were exposed to the stiff gray sky. The exposed ones looked sodden and miserable, even though it wasn't raining yet. Mr. Disgusting stood toward the end of the line. Unlike the others, he looked perfectly at ease, a book shielding his face. She squinted at the title, Straight Life. The story of Art Pepper, whoever that was. She was already anticipating the somatic effect his presence had on her. When he was within 5 feet, she'd suddenly lose her peripheral vision, along with all the saliva in her mouth, and her heart would beat as if being hunted. Seeing him was the highlight of her 2-hour commitment, and tonight she'd made adjustments to her wardrobe. Ditching her high tops and hooded sweatshirt for ballet flats and a vintage leopard print cape. She was even wearing blush and a padded bra. The line shuffled forward and soon he stood before her, smiling faintly. He was wearing the leather jacket she liked, once white, now scuffed and weather-worn, with a cryptic tire mark running directly up the back. There was a dead leaf in his hair she didn't have the nerve to pluck out. She decided to stick to the script. "How many?" she asked. She expected the usual 4 clipped syllables.
22, please.
Instead, he replied,
"I was fleeced last week."
He smiled with one side of his mouth.
"Flim-flammed," he said.
It was her turn to say something, but she was too startled by his voice, which was distinct enough to be its own creature. It had a spine and sharp little teeth.
"Actually, the cops took them," he said. "I just like saying flim-flam."
She smiled.
"Where?" "Couple blocks from here."
The needle exchange was nothing more than supplies set up on rollaway carts, situated at the end of a little-known alley wedged between an abandoned convent and a Laotian bakery in what was called the Acre, a largely Cambodian neighborhood in Lowell. They'd been here 5 months, but now it was October and soon they'd have to move indoors, somewhere under the radar.
"Must have been a rookie," she said.
Their tacit understanding with the cops was that they could operate the exchange in peace so long as the exchangers didn't do anything stupid, such as sell needles for money or dope or shoot up on the sidewalk. But occasionally, the wrong cop wandered by and busted some hapless exchanger for possession and paraphernalia. She shook out a paper bag and dropped in a starter kit. Technically, it was a 1-for-1 exchange, but if someone showed up empty-handed, she gave them a bag of 10 points and a small bottle of bleach.
"Thanks," he said. "I appreciate it, but I don't need the bleach."
No bleach meant he didn't clean his needles, which meant he probably didn't share them.
She took this to mean he was single and unattached. She handed him the bag with what she hoped was an easygoing smile. In fact, she felt queasy. It was always over too soon, and now she'd have to wait another week. He mumbled thank you, and she watched him walk down the alley. He never looked back at her. He became a furtive presence in her life. She fantasized about him every other day, usually while vacuuming. She made her living as a cleaning lady, and daydreaming was a vital part of her happiness on the job. Knowing nothing but his taste in drugs and library books, the daydreams were loose and freewheeling. She gave him a Spanish accent, a pilot's license, a way with words. She dressed him in various costumes, UPS uniform, lab coat, motorcycle leathers, and invented interesting monologues for him. They had their second conversation 3 weeks later. The site had moved into the dingy waiting room of a free clinic 2 blocks south. She was working the supply table, handing out cotton balls, bleach, alcohol swabs, condoms, and donuts donated from the Lau bakery around the corner, perhaps in gratitude for moving out of their alleyway. The fluorescent lighting made her feel like she was in high school again, back when the medication had made her skin green and her nickname was Witchy. He asked for cotton and alcohol swabs. In an effort to prolong their encounter, she offered a handful of condoms, black, their most popular color, even though she suspected he didn't need or want any, as he wasn't a sex worker and his libido was likely a distant memory. He let out a sad laugh. "What's funny?" she asked, playing dumb.
"Oh, nothing," he said and shook his head. "It's just that I have little use for condoms except as water balloons, which I also have little use for."
He looked at the floor, seemingly searching for words. She grasped for something to fill the growing silence, but she was too captivated by his voice.
"Sorry," he said. "I've made you uncomfortable with my creepy honesty."
He shook his head again. "Not at all," she said. "I'm actually a fan of creepy honesty." He made tentative eye contact. His eyes made her feel all gooey and exceptional, but the tension in his jaw told her he hadn't fixed that day, and she wondered how far from the site he lived. Was he able to wait until he got home, or was he like some of the other exchangers who spiked themselves in public?
"Would you care for a bear claw?" she asked.
He nodded.
"Take two,"
she said, breaking the one-per-person rule. He gave her a wide smile, and she took a quick inventory of his teeth. All there, reasonably white, and sturdy enough to tear linoleum. A minor miracle.
"You're very kind,"
he said in an oddly deliberate way, as though speaking in code. She watched him turn abruptly, cross the street, and disappear around a corner. He vanished for most of the winter. She figured he was either in rehab, prison, or the ground. In his absence, she grew listless and bored and almost quit. But what the hell else was she going to do on Tuesday nights? She lived alone, sans television. Her only friend was attending college in another state. She had more in common with the exchangers than anyone she knew. They were both invisible to the rest of society, they by their status as junkies, she by her status as maid, and they'd both eat pretty much anything covered in frosting. Spending time with her fellow volunteers was just as edifying. No do-gooders, no show-offs, no save-the-children types. They chain-smoked and ate nachos and hot dogs from 7-Eleven. She admired that. Mr. Disgusting reappeared one afternoon in early spring, looking like an out-of-work character actor. He wore a 7-day beard, old sunglasses with amber lenses, a long-sleeved forest green button-up, some extra weight around his middle. He shuffled up and asked to speak to her alone. Excusing herself, she walked to the corner, stopping before a boarded-up tanning salon called dark tan too. She was going to say, "It's good to see you," then opted for something more neutral. "I haven't seen you in a while."
Rehab.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.